Yane Yodam Karunamayam Anamami Chinmayam Devam Sakuru Kandavayam. Everyone, salutations to all. So 10 steps that we learned. First one, situational posture. Second, mental suggestion. Present moment awareness. Relaxation. Breath observation. Concentration. Relaxation. Fitness. Silence. We have done 4 steps so far. Preparation and posture till relaxation. Today we take the 5th one, breath observation. So we all know that in Vedanta, our personality is classified into 5 koshas, meaning 5 layers. Food sheath is the annamaya kosha, this is the body. This body is made, it is vitalized by prana, that is the pranamaya kosha. And this pranamaya kosha, subtler than that, is the manomaya kosha, the mind, seat of emotions. The prana connects the body and the mind. So if we control the prana, both body and the mind get controlled. Vijnanamaya kosha is the intellectual sheath, the unique sheath which is there only in human beings, which is not there in the plants, birds, animals, is the Vijnanamaya kosha. And the bliss sheath is the Anandamaya kosha. So this Pranamaya kosha is a very important aspect. In contemplation, when we sit, if we regulate the prana, body relaxes on one hand, and the mind also becomes quiet on the other. So what exactly is prana? The rishis have known that there is a substance from which all life emanated. It's not just in the air, it's in all the 5 elements actually. But we connect life with air because of breathing. Prana is there in all the 5 elements. So this prana is the universal energy, cosmic energy, divine energy, whatever one calls it. The power of the Lord, which has come out from Maya only. Ramana Maharshi says it is like the mind and the prana are like 2 forces which have come out of Maya only. 2 branches they are like. So if you pull one branch, the other branch also will come with it. So both these are powers of the Lord. And this prana shakti is in the air, but it is not air. It is not oxygen. It is not one of the constituents of air. It is a vital force because of which there is life. So all of them, all the living beings, they breathe in that prana through the air. But they also take prana through other aspects, which we will see. So now this pranamaya kosha, if the breathing is not regulated, and it by itself the whole kosha, not just the breathing, if it is not regulated, to go beyond body identification is very difficult. Because prana, when not regulated, mind also is not regulated, become very difficult to transcend the identification with the body, mind, intellect. So prana, in Vedanta, we don't use prana only for health purpose. One uses prana for the sake of transcending the identification. So our physical system takes in oxygen along with prana. But prana is the main thing which keeps us alive, not just the oxygen. So what does the prana do? Prana is the fuel. Just like car has diesel or petrol as the fuel. Prana is the fuel for everything that we do. Every thought that we think also consumes prana. Every movement at the body level also consumes prana. So this vital energy has to be saved, conserved. Because maximum energy goes in meditation. Biologically also, maximum sugar is consumed by the brain when it is thinking, contemplating, meditating. And hence it is that the importance of conserving, and hence brahmacharya. Brahmacharya, as Gurudev would say, is moderation in everything. No excessive indulgence, no wasteful indulgence. Conserve the energy. So prana is that rope which holds the body and the mind together. Have you ever thought that when we go to sleep, we dream? Where all we travel? How is it that we wake up in the same body? Lucky, no? We wake up in the same body. Imagine we wake up in which body, we don't know. Then who is who? No idea. Complete confusion. Prana is that rope which ensures that wherever we travel, astral body travel happens. I mean, subtle body keeps projecting so much we travel. It remains connected to this body, so we wake up again in this body. So it's a rope, and it is that rope which gets cut when the person drops the body. So then the jiva goes, finds another body. So upon death, that rope is broken. So mind along with prana and the senses, the whole subtle body departs. So this prana shakti is a very powerful force. Many people would look at somebody and the aura, you see, that energy body it is. They say, what is the aura of this person? That aura of the person is subtle, it is around the body. That is because of the prana shakti. And so this prana shakti, how do we get this prana shakti? It pervades all the five elements. So pranayama is one method, but there are many others. Since the body is also made up of five elements, it is nurtured by these five elements. So we need food is the grossest form of prana. Even in that food, cooked food is much more grosser. Raw food has more prana than cooked food. Then comes water. So we need juices, liquids, plain water to drink. We need sunlight. Nowadays people say, no, vitamin D deficiency. Because most of the time we are inside. Actually, sometimes one wonders, why are we eating food? I think only for taste and entertainment. Everything else we have to take pill. Vitamin B, vitamin C, vitamin D, vitamin E, all pills only one takes. So one has to get exposed to sunlight before 9 o'clock. Early morning, that sunlight is the best. Then the breathing. More we will see as we go along. And then how do we tap the prana from space? You cannot eat space, consume space. That is by fasting. How by fasting? The energy which generally goes downwards when we eat food will go upwards when we do fasting. By fasting, we don't mean eating special fasting food 4 times a day. Then again the prana shakti will go down on you. Plain water or just simple some fruits, bas. Then contemplate during that time when I'm doing fasting. Then the prana will go up. The ability of a person to convince the opposite person also increases when that person has done regular fasting. Because pranic levels are different for both the people. So their willpower, convincing power is much more. So these five elements, when we consume prana properly, then we have to conserve that prana. So this pranas, how are they functioning in our body? The the five pranas which take care of our body, we have learnt in Vedanta, they are prana, apana, vyana, udana and samana. Prana, what we take in, apana, what we give out, vyana is the circulation, udana is the all the reactions, and samana is the assimilation, digestion. These five pranas, they must be controlled. That is called pranayama. It is not only breathing, that is called shvasayama. So when we conserve the pranic energy, when we do our exercises, when we do get exposure to sunlight, when we drink enough water, the whole system is working harmoniously. Then when one sits for contemplation, regulating the breathing, one can transcend the body, mind and the intellect. Identification. Step by step withdrawal when we do, then we can transcend. But if these are not functioning properly, then what happens? Stomach problem, back problem, this problem, that problem. How come it got open? We don't allow them. They should not open that. Meditation especially disturbs everybody. There's no stopper inside?
No.
Oh. No, don't worry. You just tell them. Otherwise they'll keep opening. We can't do anything. Okay, so five pranas. I was saying that when we regulate our five pranas, then we sit in contemplation, then the body doesn't give any trouble. Otherwise, some kind of issue will keep happening. Many people get headache when they meditate. One of the reasons is the pranic energy is not sufficient. One is trying to concentrate. Not enough prana shakti is there. I'm not talking about any of the physical reasons. There may be some other reasons why headache also happens. But when prana is not conserved, then naturally it will lead to headache. Or one is trying to do it for a longer duration, one is not used to it. So prana shakti plays a very, very vital role. Through the breath, we continuously take prana. See, other means of prana are not continuous. Food, sunlight, water, upvas, they're not continuously there. In breaks we take. But this breathing goes on continuously. So maximum prana we take through the breath. And hence it is that the breathing also connects our mind. So every minute our mind and the breath and the body are connected. They work like one unit. Whatever happens to the mind will affect the prana and affect the body and the vice versa. Hence is it in Upadeshar, Vayu Rodhanat Liyate Manaha. By control of the breath, mind gets controlled. So the breathing reflects the attitude of the mind. Attitude of the mind affects the breathing. Both are connected to each other. So when the breathing is shallow, the mind is wandering. When the breathing is short, mind has anger. When there is passion, the breathing is different. When there is concentration, our breath is so minimum, we don't even realize we are breathing. When there is peace, then there is deep breathing. So this breath, just like the attitude of the mind affects the breathing, by changing the breathing, I can change the attitude of the mind also. If I consciously start doing deep breathing, in some time the mind will become quiet, settle down. Now this pranamaya kosha is very important to regulate for two reasons. One is sleep, other is energy. Both are very necessary. When enough deep breathing is done, prana is taken inside so that the mind doesn't feel sleepy. Relaxation and deep breathing are two very important aspects so that the first obstacle which comes, which is sleep, is overcome. Then the headache which comes also goes when I have done, I have regulated my prana shakti. Many people sit for contemplation and immediately start doing japa, start doing some chantings. And sometimes the mind will wander because one has not quietened it down. What they say now in neuroscience, no? Alpha state. The brain must come in the alpha state. When the brain comes in the alpha state, it has become so quiet. Whatever you send in the brain, it will transform the personality. So in that quiet moment, when a new auto suggestion is put, it will change the earlier conditioning and the thought pattern. So how do I bring it to the alpha state? Simple method is deep breathing. Quieten it down. So instead of sitting and straight away starting the japa or puja or anything, even if you see in puja, in the preparation itself pranayama will come. In japa also one is supposed to do pranayama. So when one does those steps, then the sadhana starts. So many obstacles which would have otherwise come, they just go. Now one important thing this said is our life is fixed by the number of breaths that we are destined to breathe according to karma. In one day, generally, it is said, we breathe for how much time? 21,600 times. If you divide it by 2, it is 10,800. Why should I divide by 2? Because I am sleeping. 8 hours or whatever it is, I am sleeping. 10,800, if you remove 2 zeros, 108. 108 is a symbol that I should take the name of the Lord with every breath of mine in the waking state. So it's a beginning milestone. One should not say after ek mala ho gaya. From 108, I have to reach to 21,600. But how will I do chanting in my sleep? That is called ajapa japa. When we will come to the japa part, I'll tell you that. It is possible. 24 hours, I can keep on taking the name of the Lord. It is possible. That is the sadhana has to be done. So this breath, our life is fixed by the breath. The shallower one breathes, the shorter is one's life. Of course, karma supersedes everything. There is no doubt in that. But this is what Yoga Shastra says, the deeper one breathes, the longer is one's life. And the examples are given of various creatures, how they breathe. See the number of breaths in a minute. Sparrow breathes 30 times in a minute. It's very shallow. So you see the sparrow, how restless it is. Keeps flying here, there, everywhere. Dog 28, goat 24, snake 16, tortoise breathes only 5. Lives so long, 200, 300 years. Number of breaths. Why are we saying this? Not to prolong our life alone, but also because of the importance in contemplation. That slower the breathing is. So when I continuously regulate my prana, I learn to do deep breathing in the state of contemplation. It will affect through the day also, my breathing will become deeper. And through the day, if my breathing becomes deeper, the mind keeps becoming relatively quiet. It will become easier for me to go deep in contemplation. And so, some of the yogis, they control their breath, bring it down to 4 per minute. Some yogis, they can control and they stop their heartbeat also. And they are still alive. Through the willpower, they are able to do so many things. So deep breathing is a must. Especially when we are doing contemplation. Even otherwise for health, deep breathing is a must because we hardly use our lung capacity. And when we don't use it, so many of these bacteria and all, they keep then all the respiratory infections and diseases and all that, they just come up. All this TB, bronchitis, cold, cough, all that starts because we don't use the lung capacity much. So in contemplation, definitely as much deep breathing as we can do. And outside contemplation, regularly, we can keep checking. Like we take a coffee break after every 2 hours, 3 hours, we have to take a breath break. Nowadays people do that. Every 2 hours, get up, walk around, sit quietly with eyes closed and focus on the breathing for 5 minutes. That is called breath break. It will relax the whole body. Now, breath and the mind, as we said, chale vate chalam chittam nischale nischalam bhave. It's a Hatha Yoga Pradipika is a text. Upadesha also same thing he said. Vayu rodhanat liyate manaha jala pakshivat rodha sadhana. So now, what are the steps? Proper pranayama when we do with proper ratio and all that, that I'm not teaching here. For that you need a proper expert yoga teacher to train. But basic steps are Urak, Antakumbak, Rechak, Bahishkumbak. Now holding is a thing where if one has any heart problem, BP problem, many other issues, then don't hold. Just take deep breath, exhale. Slow, steady and deep breathing. No jerks. It should not be like, you may do that in regular pranayama exercise whenever that is required, if that is required. But otherwise, slow. The slower one exhales, the better is the relaxation. You know, in this kumbhak, when a person holds the breath, it's very amazing how one can go into samadhi. Because all the time the breath is on. So the attention of the body to take it away, the attention to take away from the body and the breath, very difficult. So in kumbhak, what happens? Body is anyway still, breath has stopped. The mind which is doing japa gets into samadhi. Because prana is stopped. For that much time prana is stopped, that one uses and gets into samadhi. So that is a secret that is used. So when one is doing pranayama also, if you see in puja etc., when we hold the breath, then we chant Om. 33 times one will chant Om. One has to build that capacity. Don't start doing 33 times from now. Slowly, slowly one has to build that capacity. Or Gayatri mantra one chants 11 times. Not the ordinary, not the short Gayatri mantra, the full one. Om Bhu, Om Bhuha, Om Suha, Om Maha, Om Janaha, Om Tapaha, Om Satyam, Om Tatsavitvarenyam, Bhargo Devasati, Vahi, Diyo Vyona Prachodaya. To do this one time breath goes. Imagine holding that and doing 11 times. One has to build that capacity. If you read Ramakrishna Paramahamsa's gospel, he elaborates this quite a bit. That when he goes in, when he holds the mind, holds the prana in kumbhak, then chanting gets into samadhi. So that is another reason why this pranayama is done. Why contemplation? That is the only time when the prana stops. And using that window, one gets into samadhi. At the moment, don't worry about this. Just focus on simple, deep breathing. Inhalation, exhalation. How do we keep the hands? Hands should be like this, in the chin mudra. These three fingers must be together. Don't leave them loose. Together. This is the mudra part. And put the pressure here. This. So one holds like this. But as I said on the first day, these are receptors of energy. When the palms are open, we receive the energy better. The palms are closed, we still receive, but not so much as when it is open. So hold the hands like this. Now when we take the deep breath, today we are going to practice two techniques. One is, when we take the deep breath, we have to also visualize it. That when inhaling, we visualize that I am absorbing strength, purity and love. And while exhaling, we say I am giving up all weakness, impurities and hatred. And let it go out of the body and the mind. So flood the body with light and energy. And mentally say that I am taking in strength, purity and love. And I am leaving out all weakness, impurity and hatred. That is one method. Second method is OM. Most powerful mantra is OM. More about this we will take up when we come to Japa. The essence of the entire Vedic knowledge is in OM. And so, when we take the breath, mentally we chant OM. Mentally. And then when we exhale, we chant loudly. OM. If you like to hold the breath, you hold. If you don't want to hold the breath, take the deep breath, chant OM mentally, and as we exhale, chant OM loudly. Repeat this process. Mental chanting, loud chanting. Mental chanting, loud chanting. Again, if you want to hold the breath after exhaling, hold. Otherwise, leave it. In this, our session here, we will do without holding. Generally, we will do it without holding. When you practice at home, if you want to hold, that is up to you. So these are two techniques that we will practice. These are consciously taking the deep breath. When we do this, then the last thing we do is breath observation. Without regulating the breath, initially, we should avoid just breath observation. Because the mind is still not become quiet. But when we actually control the breath, make it deep, then we can observe. Prana Vikshana it is called. Raman Maharshi said, just observe the prana. And it's a fact, if we observe the prana gets controlled. In that there is no conscious attempt to breathe deeply or breathe in a ratio or visualization or chanting, nothing. Just observing the inhalation and exhalation. No attempt to make it deep or to control, nothing. Just observe how the prana goes in, what happens to the lungs, what happens to the mind, what happens to, you know, the movement of the air as it goes inside, as it comes out. Just focus on that much. Nothing to be done conscious. So this we will practice now today.